How you guys doing out there, boys and girls? Welcome to the official Party Hog Road Story Show number 7. That's 7. Lucky number 7, man. I can't believe we've had 7 of these things going already. So I could not be more stoked than I am right now for tonight. Man, it's like, is it windy down here? Must be windy in the basement. Could be the fan underneath my desk here, but I think I got all my mic check. Well, check things out here.
Check. Check. Check.
All right. I'm sure somebody will tell me soon enough if I'm not loud enough. I've had a couple of microphone issues the last couple of weeks, but I think I got everything licked for tonight here. And good to see you guys. Thanks. God, what is with my fucking hair today? Flyaway hair I got going here. This is bad, man. Anyway, welcome to the official Party Hog Road Story Show number 7. Thanks again for tuning in here tonight. I got another collection of road stories and a very, very, very special guest joining me here tonight. But before we get too far into the shoe, I need to show you guys my sponsor. This show is not going to happen without my official sponsor, Fortifications. Let's try that again. Fortification Security Solutions. If you need a locksmith, if you need your doors replaced, any kind of security, storage, lock boxes, anything done, get a hold of my friend Fort C. McMurray. Yes, folks, that's his real name. Fort McMurray. That's his real name. Hire him so he can pull out his driver's license and prove it to you. He's one of the nicest guys in this city, and he'll take care of you. So, and he'll go anywhere. I mean, if you locked yourself out of your car in say Kelowna, he'll drive to Kelowna and let you out. It'll just cost a little extra. So thanks to Fort for sponsoring the show here tonight. Don't forget, you can also see, well, you're watching this right now on Facebook, but this is for the YouTube crowd later that catches the repeat. Follow me on Facebook at Party Hog. You've also, well, there it is. After we're done this live broadcast here tonight, we're going to be putting this online on my YouTube channel, which is at The Party Hog. And don't forget, I'm also an Instagram whore. I don't know what to do on there other than put pictures of my dogs, my cats, and gig posters. That's it. So, I mean, I'm not one of those fancy guys. And as well, too, if you want, go to partyhog.com. That's my official website. And I've got all my basement shows that we do every Wednesday here with my show producer and road manager, Semenko Dave. Show number 20, the end of season 1. That's right. We've done 19 live shows here, weekly live shows from the basement for the basement show. And we're going to wrap season 1 up with... there he is. There's Semenko Dave, my road manager, making another cameo as he slowly walks past me behind the... How you doing, Dave? Dave. Get Dave to come say hi, maybe, but just that little friendly reminder, go to partyhog.com. More road story shows. Last week we had Russell Bergquist, bass player from Annihilator, and many, many other bands. The week before that, the lovely Ms. Kennedy Jensen from Jensen Interceptor, many, many other acts as well, to Klondike Kate. I've had Brian Simbaluk on the show, Mike Patchaluk, the drum tech for Brian Adams, works for Mickey Hart, and so it's been great. We've had a great little run here, but normally I would tell my a quick little, you know, I do my thing here, and I mention, I'll say, hey, this is my best gig, and this is my worst gig I've been doing. Here he is. Hey, Dave. He's looking for his stash. I can't believe Dave wants to make a cameo here. Anyway, as you tell, my best story, best road gig and my worst road gig. But you know what? I've got so much to get to here today that I'm just going to get on with the program here and get on to my first guest, my only guest. I only need this guy for tonight, trust me. He's a dear friend. He's a vocalist, a violinist. He's a songwriter. He's a producer. He's an event coordinator. He's a morning radio personality, the father of 3 great kids. He sang for the band Scrubbaloe, Caine, Small Wonder, Prism, the John Entwistle Band, before having a decent little solo career of his own. He's worked with the likes of Paul Dean from Loverboy, Burton Cummings, Giorgio Moroder, Tim Bogart from Vanilla Fudge, Ainsley Dunsbar from Frank Zappa and Whitesnake, Bobby Kimball from Toto, Timothy B. Schmidt of the Eagles, Zach Starkey from Oasis and The Who, and Richie Zito. He's had a number one record, folks. He's got a gold record to prove it as well, too. And he's also had the unfortunate luck of working with me. So, hang on here. Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce you to my guest here tonight and say hello. Oh, I'm screwing up already, Hank. How you doing? There we go. Will you please welcome to the show tonight, Mr. Henry Small, ladies and gentlemen. All right.
Hi, everybody.
It's great to see you, old friend. How you doing, bud?
I feel like I'm in a Japanese movie. My lips are like not in sync.
It'll all sync up, man. It all gets there.
It will.
It all catches up pretty quick there. It might not look in sync to you in real time, but it's working for everybody out there. In TV land and YouTube there. But there we go. Henry Small, vocalist, violinist, producer. I couldn't fit morning personality and event coordinator and all that stuff in the ticker on the bottom there. So we'll have to go with that. You're looking good, Hank.
Listening to you is making me tired. It's like you're going with the wind and the hair. Your hair looks great, by the way.
Well, that's because I'm lying. Yeah.
It looks like an 80s video. I mean, it's just like I feel comfortable with that.
I got a little fan under my desk here, and it's it's kind of blowing at the wrong angle here.
He looks down.
Yeah, the truth is, the best part about doing this show, Hank, is I don't have to wear pants. So I just hope. Are you wearing?
I needed to hear that. No, I'm not actually.
You're not actually wearing pants. Good to see you. So you're coming to us live from Kamloops, British Columbia.
Yeah.
What's it like there today, my friend?
It's now it's sunny, a little chilly, but it's sunny. So we've had a really kind of up and down summer. It got hot and then it was not so hot and now it's hot again. So it's been good.
Well, you're looking pretty tan there, buddy. So
yeah. But
then you're more comfortable going outside with your shirt on than I am. So
with my shirt on or
shirt off?
I
meant God.
I'm just going to help you here as much as I can.
I'd appreciate that. You have much more experience at this than I do. That's for damn sure. I'm the new kid on the block here. That's Christ almighty. Anyway, before we get any further here, I sent you a text and I asked you, I hope you have a drink. Have you got a drink there?
Yeah. Water.
Oh, water? Well, that'll work.
Yeah.
Give me a cheers, buddy.
Okay, man.
Come on, man.
That's awesome. I don't know which way the glass will
there
show.
Show it up in the camera. There we go. Cheers, man. Good to see you, buddy. All right. Booze goes up. Booze goes down. Oh, breaking out the good tequila tonight for you, my friend.
I had a couple last night, and I don't usually drink, so I'm a little,
a little under the weather. Hey. Yeah. Well, let's start the show here. I mean.
Sure.
I've got some bio to run through, and then I'm going to hit you up with.
I thought I might die before you actually got to the show. But.
No, we're good. I got the three questions I hit every guest up with,
sure.
Which is the best. What's your best gig? What was your worst gig? And what is your craziest road story? But man, I tell you,
I could give you that in 5 seconds.
Were they all three the same or what?
No. But it was interesting. You made me think, because you most of the time you don't remember a lot because it's always the same. You go from one place to the next. You're staying in a hotel. You're in front of an audience. But there was one gig that I really came to mind after you asked me that earlier. I idolized Delaney Bramlett.
Oh yeah,
from Bonnie and Delaney. Years ago, and they played with Clapton and mm-hmm. George Harrison and Southern rock. But I idolized him, and I had the good fortune. It's a funny story. Playing just a tiny club in the San Fernando Valley, and I was with Burton, and we got up and we sang. think you better you try to find another man, a Righteous Brothers duet.
Yeah.
Which Burton and I did, and we had a lot of fun doing that and did it really well. But I got off the stage, and this guy, tiny little stage club, and this guy comes up to me, and I went, oh my God, it's Delaney Bramlett.
Wow.
And he said, man, that was so good. You got a great voice. And I got to tell you something, that for me was that moment was pretty cool. He later went to the bathroom later, and he comes up beside me in the urinal, and he got his fly caught on his dinger. And actually, the true story, I swear to God, and he started hollering, and I couldn't figure out what the hell was going on. And he said, oh, and there was blood and the whole deal.
Oh,
and he actually, he couldn't unzip what he had done. And they called an ambulance. Oh. It literally called an ambulance. True story, swear to God.
Oh, my God.
I know. So much for idolatry, I guess.
Yeah, you meet your idol and have that moment, and then he just catches his dick in the zipper like anybody else does.
That's pretty good.
Oh, man. So, Henry, first up, where were you born? I know most of these answers, but for our audience here today, I'd like to ask you, where were you born?
Born in Beacon, New York.
New York.
Yeah, leap year, 1948.
You are a leap year baby.
Yeah, 18.
So you're only 18 right now. Jesus.
I know, it's been a hard life.
What was your, you comfortable with your real name or?
I mean, I didn't really, my dad died when I was 2 years old, and his name was Mikroutsikos. Greek name.
Yes.
And my mother, being my mother at the time, never legally changed it. She just decided that micro meant small, so she took on the name Small, which created a lot of havoc later on trying to get a passport or a pension or whatever. It was like, when I, you know, your birth certificate says something totally different. But yeah, that's the original name.
So you're born in the U.S., but that's all been rectified now. You became a Canadian citizen about 10 years ago, I do believe.
Oh, no, probably 16 years.
At least.
And glad and so happy and proud, honestly, good. With what's going on.
Well, you've spent most of your life here in Canada.
Well, I spent from 1969 to 1976. And then went to I went down to record in Los Angeles. Yeah, and Joe Wizard, a producer at the time, Boss Gag, Silk the Grease guy, saw us open for Jeff Beck at Massey Hall in Toronto and flew the band down to record with him. So there you go.
Wow.
Yeah, I thought I was on my way.
Well,
I'm in Kamloops, Mike.
Let's back up a little bit. What was your real first musical memory? What was the thing that made you kind of go, that's it, that's what I want?
Well, there's been a couple. Early on, I watched a guy on TV named Florian Zabok, believe it or not, which was a TV show in the States in the early 50s. And I started begging my parents for a violin. Later on, when I heard Purple Haze, I decided that I wanted to play the violin like Jimi Hendrix. And that's that moment.
That's when you kind of merged the two together.
Yeah, I kind of went, whoa. So, I got to try to do that.
I do have a picture of you with one of your first groups here.
And
ironically called The Group. And that would be you in the role of Betty on Lead Tambourine there on the right.
Oh, that's man.
Veronica on keyboards. There's Jughead on the drums.
I know. Actually, the guy on drums, Joe Maggio, it's his birthday today. He's 75 years old today.
Happy birthday, Joe.
Yeah. I don't think he'll be watching this, but whatever.
Now, where was this? This would have been in New York as well?
Yeah, this is at Potsdam, New York, which was about 10 miles from the Canadian border. And that's how I became interested in Canada, because we used to go up to Montreal to see the R&B groups, you know, Sam and Dave and James Brown. And so it was only an hour and a half away. So we used to go up there. And and that's when I became interested in Canada. I thought it was cool.
So I love the Beatles suits. And
I know.
And
I look like I look like Ringo in that, baby.
You do. You got the look there for sure. So, well, that brings me to my next question, which was what brought you to Canada? Now, you said 1969. Was it something musical that brought you to Canada, a gig offer, or just wanted a change?
Well, I had been drafted in 1967, I think, to go to Vietnam.
Oh, boy.
And at that time, not being political or anything, but I thought, kind of like Muhammad Ali, who was one of my idols, and I thought, what the hell, I'm going to go to Vietnam and fight for democracy? It didn't make sense to me. Mm-hmm. And there's a story there, too. I mean, in the middle of this lineup with guys shitting their pants and acting crazy and whatever, this sergeant who was just horrific, I mean, yelling at everybody, whatever, but in the middle of this chaos, he came up to me and in such a kind voice, said, "Son, what's wrong?" And I guess I had looked down in the mouth because I answered every question I could wrong and, you know, trying to get out of this thing. Anyway, it's one of those things where you can't explain it. And he took me aside and I saw a board of psychiatrists, three guys, and told them my family history with my stepfather, who was kind of a violent guy and whatever. And basically they deferred me. But that kind of said to me, you know, maybe not to go to Canada as a draft dodger, but I had friends in Canada that had seen me play, and they offered me a gig with the Gainsborough Gallery at the time to come up and sing with those guys. So I came to Alberta.
That's kind of where I know a lot of Edmontonians will remember the name Wes Dukas. Dacus, sorry. I knew I was going to say that
wrong. See what I mean?
Yeah.
Have another drink.
Okay. Well,
yeah, go for it.
Wes Dacus. The Gainsborough Gallery, named after an art gallery in Calgary. Now, the Edmonton history on the band was that they were together here in Edmonton for about 5 years and then relocated down to Calgary. And that's where they hooked up with you. Is that correct?
I don't know if that is correct. I know that Mel Deegan, a great, great singer, he was part of the band, and they wanted to do kind of like a duo, you know, lead singer thing. Mm-hmm. But the rest of the band was from Calgary, as far as I knew. But as I said, Mel was from Edmonton.
So that band eventually disbanded, and the elements came into play for the first band called Cannonball. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, Gainsborough, we recorded in Clovis, New Mexico. At the time, a lot of Canadian groups would go down to Clovis, New Mexico, and that was with Norman Petty. Mm-hmm. And Norman Petty was Buddy Holly's producer. Wow. So I got to meet Buddy Holly's parents and actually held his guitar.
No way.
Yeah. So that was a big kick.
So after that became, you guys became this band.
Cannonball, yes.
Cannonball. I love the Serpico look you got going there, dude. And that corduroy jacket, man. That is. Now, people out there might recognize the person on the lower left is Paul Dean from Loverboy.
Right.
Now, you guys formed Cannonball about 1970, according to my notes here, and you guys played all over Western Canada for about 3 years. In 1972, Jim Cale from the Guess Who joined.
Well, he didn't join Cannonball. He joined Scrubbaloe.
Scrubbaloe, as it became Scrubbaloe. That's right.
Cannonball morphed into that. Yeah.
So you got a great backstage. Man, those pants, too. I'm telling you.
Come on.
Those are awesome pants, my friend. Like
funny what time does. But you know what? I was in a store the other day and they had pants like that. So if you live long enough, it'll come back.
I just wish I could zoom in to see what's on the deli tray there, you know, if it's like Spinal Tap or not, kind of.
Oh, so, man.
But now you guys were doing the 6 night a week grind, correct? Like the Alberta grind back then and with the jams and all that stuff, correct?
Yeah. I mean, there was a lot of traveling. It wasn't 6 nights a week, and that came later, but a lot of traveling. I mean, you would get, you know, and it was funny in those days, we had a van and, you know, everybody piled in with a couple of cases of crackling rosé, I guess it was called.
Yeah.
Some other things. And we would drive all over Alberta. Yeah. It was a fun time. It was a free time. There was no phones. There was no nothing. You just went and had a good time, basically.
But with probably an insane amount of equipment as well, too. Like large, everything was large. The PA, the cabinets.
Yeah. Well, you know what's happened with amps and everything else, right? And yeah. PAs and big U-Haul trailer or whatever on the back. You know, that's the way we did it.
Did you guys have to do those bullshit Saturday jams as well?
Not that band so much.
Yeah.
I mean, in most of the groups that I've been in, if we played a place for 6 nights or 7 in some cases, you would have to do a jam on Saturday as well or Sunday, one of the two. Quebec City, for example, with Scrubbaloe Caine, we played 8 o'clock to 2 o'clock, 10-minute breaks, and I mean 10-minute breaks. And 7 nights a week plus a matinee on Sunday from 2 to 6.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Yeah. But
you get tight.
On saying that, yeah, Scrubbaloe was probably, you know, now I realize it, probably the most exciting live band that I ever played with.
Here's a shot. This is really one of my favorite promo shots of all time of the vintage promo stuff. This is Scrubbaloe Caine. Circa 1973, and God. You guys moved to Toronto, became Scrubbaloe Caine, you signed to RCA Records,
mm-hmm.
and released your debut album,
mm-hmm.
Called Round One. You guys got a Juno nomination in 1974 as Most Promising Group as well.
I didn't know that.
You did not know that. I found that out on a couple of sources. Yeah, you guys were up for a Juno there in 74 there, so...
Thanks, but, Mike.
Well,
I'm feeling better about myself now.
That's good. But I mean, that's a great album cover, though, too. I mean, this is and the
that,
songs
that was
this.
Done, believe it or not, that whole thing was created probably on the 45th floor of a skyscraper at the RCA building in New York City.
No
and
way.
And this is how much money the record companies had in those days. They erected this whole thing, costumes for all the guys around the ring are all executives and RCA people. So thought that was pretty cool.
That's something. Now, musically, like I was doing some research on the album. I mean, I own a copy of it. I've listened to it many times, but I just wanted to see what the gist of it was, the write-up on it. From back then, see if I could find any old reviews, and it was pretty well received. But you guys had a very different sound, more like a Black Oak, Arkansas, kind of a country southern rock kind of a sound.
Yeah, I wasn't intentional. I mean, we had a little bit of country, we had a little bit of rock and roll. Obviously, Trouble is still one of my favorites off that album, and Crazy About a Blues Guitar was also. Pretty strong. Feeling Good on Sunday. God, they've been playing that on QXM or whatever in Toronto on Sundays for years. So, yeah. You know, it was one of those bands that's one of the best gigs was opening for the Guess Who in Toronto at the CNE, is it in Toronto?
Yeah.
And that the crowd went pretty crazy, and that was 40,000 people, so it was big kick at the time.
I got another Scrubbaloe Caine picture here of you guys doing a record store appearance.
Oh boy.
And from the looks of it on the left, it was like this must have been early in the day, because I'm thinking in the right picture side there, it must have been a little later in the day. That's you look, that's you with Sam the record man, actually Sam the record man right there.
Yeah, He's no longer around. I don't think he's around anymore. His stores aren't.
I think he passed a few years ago. And the famed store they took down the neon and that. I think they saved it in a museum or something. So, me next. You next, buddy. So, from there, there is one other thing. You guys. I discovered that there was a second. Oh, let's get you in there too. Jesus Christ.
What are you doing? What are you up
to? I know I'm hitting all the wrong buttons here, buddy, is what I'm doing. There we go. Now we're backwards. Let's try that again. Switch it around.
This has been a really fun show so far, I gotta say.
You know, now there was a second Scrubbaloe Caine album recorded, wasn't there? That was never released.
Well, there was supposed to be one, and the band's main writer was Al Foreman, and he got married and decided that he was going to be a songwriter, and so it never really happened. There was a song called "I'm a Dreamer" or something, but it was kind of lame, and that was it for that configuration.
That would kind of explain it. Yeah, I spent about an hour trying to find that album everywhere today,
and even a song or a clip
or anything like that. But now you guys also appeared on a CBC TV show called Live, and I tried finding a clip of that as well. No luck. That would be gold to find. That would be really something.
Yeah, I sincerely loved that band a lot. It was fun.
Great band. Good stuff. Now, from there, you joined a band in Toronto.
Right.
Called Small Wonder. Now, can you tell me how that came about? Like, how did just the band get started? Because, I mean, I'll be honest. I really am into this band. I own both the albums, and I think the musicianship is ridiculous on this stuff.
Yeah.
And it's very hard to find. It's very hard to find information. It's hard to find the albums. So, I'm curious, what kind of got the ball rolling with Small Wonder in Toronto? And
well, I mean, Scrubbaloe, to be honest, I'll be real honest with you. Scrubbaloe broke up, and we had to work. We were living, in those days, you didn't make a lot. Well, in those days, now we don't make any money. Yeah. But in those days, you know, in order to pay your rent and eat, do whatever, the band broke up, and I swear to God, within a week and a half, we had another band, and I started booking it in Toronto on the strength of Scrubbaloe, but it was a totally different kind of band, and I knew Jimmy Phillips, who later was joined Burton Cummings later on. Jimmy Phillips was from upstate New York. I'd gone to college with him and had played with him, and he had a friend, now I can't even think of his name, Jerry Morin, who was very talented, and he had a double neck bass and guitar thing going on. And when Jimmy wasn't playing with his left hand bass, then Jerry would take over. It was a very interesting group. And great harmonies, great music. Great musicians. Anyway, I don't know about the great music.
Well, I mean, there's some songs that are typical of the era.
Yeah, you know? I mean, we were scouted by A&M, and it was between. Here's me again. It was between us and a group called Styx, and they went with Styx, obviously. So that's what happened after CBS.
Who ever heard of Styx, man?
Exactly.
Chumps, man. I never heard of those guys.
I don't see you doing interviews with Styx. had to drag me out.
So now you guys got signed to Columbia Records, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. We did two albums, but when we were done with Columbia, that's when A&M came around. And you know it is what it is. So
that got me to LA,
and I was, you know, in the beginning stages of that, it was really kind of cool.
I recall you telling me you guys did a showcase in Toronto, and the record executives saw you and.
No, we opened for Jeff Beck.
Oh.
And Joe at Massey Hall. Yeah, and are you okay over there?
You just throw that out casually. Jeff Beck at Massey Hall. Like,
geez. Well, I mean, that's where Joe Wizard saw us, and he said he came backstage, and he was kind of a. He was a different guy, and he said, yeah, I'd really, really like to take you guys to Los Angeles to record. And, of course, you heard this stuff all the time. I never even took it seriously, but it actually happened. And that was pretty cool.
And there it is. That's the result of it, the first Small Wonder album, released in 1976.
Yeah.
Now, you also landed a 3-year songwriting deal with Irving Almo Music.
Jeez, you did your homework, didn't you?
Oh, you betcha. Well, what I found interesting about Irving Almo Music, they were the company that bought all the Beach Boys songs from Murray Wilson.
For $50,000 or something, right?
I know. I read that story today, and I was like, holy shit,
that,
man.
That catalog was worth hundreds of millions of dollars.
It
was their dad. It was actually their dad that sold it for like $50,000.
Yeah. Good old Murray K. Wilson, wasn't it?
That wouldn't lead to good familial relations, that's for sure.
Now, that was the one album. Here's a copy of the second album, Small Wonder, called Growing. Now, this is a really difficult album to find. I had a hell of a time getting this record, a pristine copy on eBay. I ripped it all into digital and put copies of it online, and I've been catching up on some of the comments, and I tell you, the people that leave comments behind they basically go like this: holy shit, I haven't heard this record in years, can't believe you found it and posted it, thank you very much. So
that's nice to hear.
It is. I mean, there was a real audience. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be the coolest clip I'll probably ever play on this show. I'm going to play this clip, and then I'm going to ask a question about it afterwards. But, ladies and gentlemen, may I present to you...
I got a bad feeling.
from the band Small Wonder, performing on Bert Sugarman's Midnight Special. Check this out. I've been watching you for days. That's just killer. That really is just killer, buddy.
It's like, it's interesting to watch. That's for sure. It feels like it's somebody else, right?
Yeah, you know, I guess.
But their show business, that's a perfect example. We're on this big, big show. It was a big show at the time on TV.
Boy,
and we did it like at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to get out of you. People think, oh, the midnight special. Oh my God, yeah, it's yeah, just got. But yeah. You guys were there at 8 in the morning for this.
Eight in the morning. And oh my these God, guys, the work guys that were putting. They say, "What's the name of the band?" And they pick out the letters to put on the back, right? And and they're eating donuts, and they didn't care, right? And then later they super, you know, they cut it, and they cut to the live audiences that night. So it was interesting.
So just literally you're playing that
You're
hard.
Playing to nobody. You're playing to three guys sitting there drinking coffee, having a donut, and going, you know, get these guys out here.
Next up, it's Rex somebody or other, or John Travolta singing his latest single. You know, my God,
but yeah, I mean, man, that's the way it was. That's the way it was.
But I mean, still,
it reunited me with my parents because they kind of had disowned me because I was doing this rock and roll thing, and they were more classically trained. My brother was an opera singer. My mother was an opera singer. And when they saw me on national TV, it was kind of like, oh, you know, we kind of thought it was pretty good.
Oh, man.
I'm telling you.
Oh, I mean, like musically, you guys were like, there was some real good chops going on. Great for harmonies.
Yeah, it was good. It was good.
Good stuff. I mean, and just... being in LA to release an album out of LA in 1976, which is considered to be, you know, 76-77 is considered to be the two best years of music that came out, the catalogs, everybody's stuff that came out. So I mean, just being part of that whole thing, and plus just being on that show, man, that's gonna be,
I mean, going to LA and having a major producer and you know, for people that had never, you know, small town kind of stuff, and to do that was a lot of fun,
So, after that project had run its course, how did you hook up with your next project from there? Because you said that you knew the one guitar player, Jimmy, went to go work with Burton. Is that how you got the gig with Burton Cummings?
No, actually, I got a call from Jim Martin, who is Burton's lifelong road manager. And he called me and he said, do I know, you know, he said that they had hired Jimmy from the Small Wonder Band. And he said they were looking for a couple of female singers to do backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And at the time, I didn't have anything going on. And I went, I'll do it. Thinking as kind of a joke, right? Maybe hoping a little bit, I don't know. But he goes, oh man, he said, you would do that? And I said, you bet your ass I would do that. Mm-hmm. And that's how that happened.
And that's where I kind of will interject a little bit here. My very, very first rock concert I ever went to
I want to hear this one.
Was Burton Cummings at the Memorial Arena
in
Kamloops, BC. Me and my friend Shane Moritz, we took the afternoon off. Well, we skipped school the afternoon. We rode our rode the bus down to the Memorial Arena there from Sahali, and we stood out in front and waited for 4 hours, not realizing that, you know, it wasn't going to be that big a lineup. But we didn't care. It was our first concert. We didn't know what to do. Yeah. We got in there, went to the front of the stage. I seem to recall the opening act was Shama or Trauma out of Vancouver, something like that.
Trauma, maybe.
Trauma, yeah.
Not sure.
Or maybe even Stonebolt.
It could have been Stonebolt because we did do some things with Stonebolt for sure.
Now, the reason I'm bringing this up is because...
What is the reason, Mike?
The reason is this picture, Henry.
Oh.
The reason is I recall being an impressionable 14-year-old boy standing at the front watching his very first rock concert. And I was very into Burton Cummings at the time. I had his Rhapsody album. I loved it. And then came a time I saw you in the back singing harmonies and playing some violin. And I'm telling you, it was when you came out to do the song Dragging Him Down the Line with him, I was floored, just floored by your vocal performance. And I found it strange that he said your name that night. And I'm very, very bad with names, but I remembered your name from that night on. And the reason I'm bringing this up is that just fast forward, jump ahead in the calendar a little bit, about 20 years later, 21 years later, I'm working at the recording studio in Kamloops with you, and this picture from that concert that night was hanging right above the board. And for me, it was just a weird experience to be, you know, you were my first rock concert, and then 21 years later, I'm working in a recording studio with you, and this picture's hanging over the mixing board. And I tell you, buddy, just from a personal thing, that meant a lot to me. I was a fan. What can I say? I was a fan. I was a big fan of yours and remembered that performance. And I'd like to share that performance with everybody right now from a CBC special. Get a load of this stuff, man. This is gold. This is Henry at his kick-ass best. Look out. Here we go. Pretty cool stuff, man. You sing the shit out of that. I mean,
He brought the best out of me. Vocally, yeah. You know, he's such a talented guy and a great singer. For a while, it really pushed me to be better.
That's good. Yeah.
Go ahead.
I didn't hit your I didn't hit your mic mute before you said you had to go to the bathroom real bad.
I have to go to the bathroom real fast. So play another clip.
Tell you Are you sure? I do have another. Tell you what, let's get into the Prism stuff, and then I can play the Don't Let Them Know one, and you go for a quick peter in that one, and we can. Okay. Okay. Now, I get it, man. I get it. So let's move on.
Tracy's sitting here, and I leaned over, and I go, I gotta really go to the bathroom, Pat. And she goes, I hear you.
I was just literally a half inch away from muting your mic just as you said it. So we got a comment that said, yeah, you might want to mute his mic, LOL. That's from a McSal man buddy, Mike Brazil. Good to see you, buddy. Thanks for tuning in tonight. So anyway, Kira Hogue is there as well, too. Hi. It's nice to say hi, everybody.
Oh, Kira's great singer.
Kira's, she's really good.
Great singer.
Boy, we got some of the people tuning in tonight. Mike Patchulik. Oh boy. Yeah, nice to see you. Thanks for tuning in and watching the show here tonight. Anyway, in late 1980, the story goes, and I know this because it was in either Kamloops Daily newspaper, the article was, Paul Dean from Loverboy was sitting in Bruce Allen's office in Vancouver. Prism was looking for a new lead singer, and Paul Dean suggested his old friend, Henry Small. You got the gig, and the album Small Change was released in 1981, spawning the hit Don't Let Them Know. So can you elaborate just a little bit more on that, getting that call? What were you doing at the time kind of thing that brought you into the Prism world?
Well, I mean, you know how it is. We had just finished, I'd finished with Burton. I got a call from Bruce Allen, and at that time Bruce was a big manager for sure. He had everybody, and I didn't have anything really going on, and to join a band that had a track record and a record deal and whatever, so I said yes.
Well, yeah, I mean, they offer you a job, you're going to say yes, right? Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, in that situation, it just seemed like a good thing to do. And it was a good thing to do. I mean, I experienced things with Prism that I hadn't experienced before, that's for sure.
Now, you guys had a couple of hits in Canada, one of them being the song Rain, which I think has got one of the most magnificent choruses I've ever heard in any song.
I love that song.
It really is. I remember hearing it on NL 610 radio in Kamloops growing up. And, you know, it was just, man. And I have to admit, even at the time, I didn't know it was a Prism song at all. I heard the song. I go, Jesus, that's a good song.
Yeah, it was a totally different sound. I mean, everybody from the original band was gone. Lindsay had left, and Al Harlow had left, and it was pretty much the producer's call, and he picked the band, basically, and that recorded that album. And, that's the way it went down.
So, with Small Change, you did have a number one hit, a number one mainstream rock chart hit on the charts, and number 39 on Billboard for the song written "Don't Let Him Know" by written by Brian Adams and Jim Vallance, and it only reached number 49 on the Canadian charts, which is surprising. You know, number one mainstream rock chart, number 39 on Billboard, but only 49 in Canada. Now,
well, I think there was a backlash to that because Prism had, they had a sound, and Ron Toback was a great singer, and he was very unique. And so all of a sudden, you know, there's this whole new Prism thing that really wasn't connected to the past. in any way, really, aside from the manager was the same, and that was pretty much it. So, yeah, I you know, it was tough because I still get, you know, YouTube things and stuff where people go, oh, yeah, the guy's a phony or, you know, blah, blah, blah. But it is what it is.
Yeah, well, that's just it, Henry. I mean, I found it to be really unfair that you were treated that way. You know, you were, like I said, you were offered a job and you took it. You didn't kick Ron out of the band. You didn't make any of the management decisions. You were just a new singer. And it's, you know, it can't be an enviable position to be put into, much like, you know, when Randy Rhoads died from the Aussie band, the guitar players he had, they were all like, you know, you show up. When Sammy Hagar replaced David Lee Roth, you know, he has to go out there in front of an audience and it's like, where's Dave? Where's Dave? All this. So that's really got to be a difficult position to be in. But then, that being said, you know, there's a little bit of na-na-na-na-na to it when you end up doing this on the TV show Solid Gold. Here we go. Great song. I play that song still in my show. I played it in the basement show a few weeks back there. It's just a stellar vocal performance on that song for sure. Oh, there we go.
Am I on again?
There you go.
Those two guys, I mean, Brian Adams and Jim Vallance, just a great songwriting team. Actually, another tragic story in my career. They actually, when we were done with the second Prism album, they sent a tune called Run to You that was written for me to do for a Prism album. And of course, by then everything had been recorded and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. We said, whatever. I didn't want to do a song about jogging. You know?
It's jogging stuff. You're jogging stuff. Your cigarette keeps going out, eh? can't keep my smoke lit. So Beat Street, let's get into Beat Street. Well, yeah, before we get there, hang on. I got another picture I want to show everybody here tonight. This must have been quite the rush. You're on Sunset Boulevard in California, and there it is, Prism. Small change. There it is, a fucking billboard on Sunset Boulevard in Los Angeles, just literally blocks away from Capitol Records. Like, that's...
That's pretty cool.
That's a pretty cool feeling, you know, to get that picture. And I did something for you here. I decided to Google this page up, and there's the exact corner today. So if what used to be a liquor store is now a Pink Dot liquor store.
It's still a liquor store. That should still, be happy.
Still works, but there's still the same corner and all that. Now Beat Street was the second Prism album for the U.S., for the Capitol Records deal. Now, with your permission, I'll be the one to just kind of put that out there. You know, I mean, you were wrongly blamed for stealing the name and using it for what was considered a Henry Small solo record. Whereas, the truth was that that's not the case, right? I mean, you didn't own the name.
No, I had nothing to do with any of it. The producer picked the guys for the album. It wasn't my call. He picked the songs. Bruce was the manager. He owned the name. Had nothing to do with anything, right? It just came along with the Prism name, basically. And, you know, when you have diehard fans, which Prism had for many years, you know, I understand it. It wasn't great to be targeted, but yeah, I understood it.
So in light, it's not like a personal thing. It was more of a music business decision.
Yeah.
Bruce was trying to break Prism into the States, and
which was happening and quite successfully. I mean, that one Prism album pretty much, you know, it was about 500,000 copies in the States, mm-hmm. and another 75,000 in Canada. So it did pretty well because Prism had never really done anything in the States. So it was, but it was one of those things, you know, and I, at the time, man, I was happy to go along with whatever, you know. I had a billboard on Sunset. That was a big deal for me.
Well, yeah, and that's it. I mean, that's the point I'm trying to make, is that I think you got caught in the crossfire unfairly, because literally this was an old band put into a new recording contract, which was then made into a different band, which then became a new band, but still had the old band's name.
I got a headache from that.
I know. We'll watch that back later. And we'll make, but I mean, it rubs me the wrong way a lot when I see that stuff, because I do feel that you take a lot of flack for that, and you had nothing to do with that. It was all management, the music business. It's a fickle, shitty business.
Yeah,
and you know, it's usually the guys on stage that have to take the hits, as opposed to the people pulling the strings in behind, which are the ones making those decisions and stuff, and that
and making the money.
Yeah.
By the way.
Yeah. Know. Well, now I want to note here that the band Roxette in 1986, the guitarist songwriter, his name's Per Gessle. Sorry if I got that wrong. It's Swedish. He once said in an interview that Prism's Beat Street was a huge musical influence on Roxette and the sound that they had created. Now,
wow, I never knew that.
That was, yeah, I remember reading that about 12 years ago, and I was like, wow, you know, he was doing it, being interviewed, and that was one of the things that he brought up. They said, what were some of your influences? And it was like, well, yeah, there was this album. I mean, the album did pretty well in Europe.
In Europe, it was those two albums, Small Change, and in Europe, the Prism was very, very popular. I didn't find that out until years later, of course, because you don't get royalties, you don't hear anything. They just, you know, sell it, and you'll hear about it maybe. But yeah, those two albums in Europe, I just got an email from a guy in the Ukraine and said it was his biggest influence, and he's in a hard rock kind of band, and which surprised me, but it, you know, yeah, they were interesting albums.
That's what really caught my eye when I was reading up a lot about this album. If you read comments from Canadians, it is what it is. If you read comments from the Europeans and that, they just love this album, and its influences, the sound, and you worked with the list of people you worked with on this record: Timothy B. Schmidt from the Eagles, Bobby Kimball from Toto, Richie Zito on guitar, and that as well too. You also did a song. You wrote a song with Richie Zito that ended up on an Eddie Money record. Correct? Am I right?
Yeah, it was something that I later recorded with the Entwistle band. That was the first single, and that was Stranger in a Strange Land, which I wrote with Tommy Whitlock at Marauder Studios. And Tommy went on to do the Top Gun soundtrack, which I was offered, and because of contractual problems, I turned it down. Tommy's worth about $30 million now, and I have to go to the bathroom in a bottle. Okay.
So the Top Gun soundtrack. Jesus. I mean, now, I have a special treat for a lot of the audience out there. There good. Is there is an and you know what, buddy? If you got to run to the bathroom, I gotta go. Okay, you go. That's fine, and I'll cover for you. Okay, you go do your thing, and I'll set this all up. All right. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to pop out solo here. Okay, this is what I'm going to do. I've got a very special treat for everybody here tonight. I'm going to be playing you the Lost Prism video. Okay, this video was never released. This is from the album Beat Street. And this is a video featuring my friend Henry Small and what the band was called, Prism. And here we go. I just should shut up and play this. Never released, never broadcast. Are you guys ready for this? Check this out. Exclusive. You know, I had to throw in the blue steel look there at the end there. So.
That's a laugh.
your Zoolander move there at the end. There. Now, that's awesome. Okay, man, we're an hour in here and I'm still going through your bio. We're going to pick up a little bit of speed here. Okay, my friend, because I don't want to keep you too long. I know you got to go to bed early.
No,
and
I'm
stuff.
Good now. I'm good now.
Okay, good.
Go as long as you want.
So now let's move on to like 1985 here. Okay. How did you get the job with the John Entwistle band? How did that come to be?
I was playing at Lee's studio, Rear Studios in the Valley, and a guy came, Alan McDougall, an English guy, came in, and he really liked the band, and he was hanging, he brought Don Henley to see the, you know, it was like a whole deal. And Alan took me aside, and he said, and this was the band with Tim Bogert and Ainsley Dunbar and Devin Powers from San Francisco, and it was a great band. And Alan said, you know, you should send a cassette to John Entwistle. They've gone through hundreds of auditions. They're still looking for a lead singer. And at the time, I was really happy with the band that I had. But I mean, I heard John Entwistle, and I kind of went, okay. So I sent the cassette. You know, you go, whatever, you don't think anything's going to happen from it. And I got a phone call, and they flew me over, and that was the beginning of that relationship.
How long did you stay at the castle or at John's castle, or were you staying?
Well, it wasn't a castle, but it was an old English mansion.
That's right,
in
yeah.
the country. He had a house in London, which I stayed at on the weekends, because we used to go down on the weekends and go to private clubs and spend the nights there, because those clubs used to open up at like 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock at night. And we'd come out in the morning when people were going to work.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy is right.
Yeah, I can only imagine. So, like, he had the...
Oh, boy.
Did he have the studio in the mansion there?
Yes, he did. He had a studio, and it was awesome. I mean, you're in the English countryside. You're playing with great guys, Zach Starkey, he's a great drummer. And
you were like his first band though, right? Like he was 19
years old.
So like his first real recording project, kind of like,
I think he had recorded before that, but nothing that serious. But John recognized that that Zach was every bit as good as his father, and because he was a combination of he was solid like Ringo. He played what was necessary, but he took drum lessons from Keith Moon.
Yeah, I was going to say he had both of them. Like, yeah, Keith Moon and Ringo.
So it really now, you know, he's still playing with a Who, and he's wonderful drummer.
I saw them.
And a good guy, too.
I saw him about 2 years ago, and God, yeah, he's a really great drummer. So tell me about that. Now, I know I was leading to this. That first day you got there, I believe there was a party at John's mansion. And
there was always a
party that I know you had a few pictures from. They used to hang up in this studio. I tried to get them, but they're in storage right now, so that's okay. I saw the pics. A lot of people that have been in the studio, I've seen those pics. It's literally you and Eric Clapton and Jeff Beck and Ron Wood and Ringo Starr and Barbara Bach and John, and you guys are all just like casually hanging out, and you're like the new guy in the room. I mean, got to elaborate on that. You get there and it's like, oh, we're having a party tonight. And
Well, everybody, every English guy, and I always idolized black R&B musicians, and I idolized English musicians, and to see all those people and I thought, yeah, I'm one of the gang, right? And I'm sitting at this table, and you got Bill Wyman across there and Keith Richards and Jeff Beck's running around and blah blah blah. And then the photographers hit, and they climbed all over me, pushed me out of the way to take pictures of everybody else.
Excuse me, so, can you move left, please?
Yeah, that brought me back down to earth in a hurry. But it was really great. I mean, I remember being introduced by Ringo to Keith Richards. And I remember, and this is like, what, 1986, 85, 86?
Yeah.
Man, I got to tell you something. I shook his hand, and I looked him in the eye, and it scared me. It really, it was like a crack in hell had opened up and something had crawled out. He was always, but he had a reputation as, people passed away hanging around with him because he would go for days.
Yeah.
And the fact that he's still alive now is boggling. So much for zinc and vitamin C.
It only goes so far, eh? Yeah. Oh, my God. So you guys had obviously been working. Well, here, I'm going to show one picture before I get onto the album cover here, because this is a picture of you at the mansion.
Mm-hmm.
I get my little bug out of there. The John Entwistle. I love these old promos, like autographed promo. And now people in Edmonton might recognize that ticket on the right as the ticket stub from when the John Entwistle Band played here at the Rex Hotel, the Metro, in Edmonton on Saturday, August 6th of 1988. My girlfriend was at that show. She saw you guys that night. Everybody I talked to in Edmonton seems to have been there that night. It was like the three people that were at the first Police gig turns into 10,000, you know. It was like, oh, yeah, I was there. I saw. But you guys were working on this album here, The Rock. And this was quite a departure for John's sound. He was trying to go for more of a band sound and really kind of get into, you know, sounding like a commercial rock band, basically. Am I right?
Yeah. I mean, obviously, his songs, I think, and still do that. He was a great songwriter. I mean, and the only thing that people really remember is Boris the Spider.
And
he had a lot of great songs. I thought he was a very interesting songwriter for sure.
Now he had there is one other bum bum ba bum story. Is this?
Oh, I know this is it. Like the story of Henry getting his ass kicked.
No. It's the story of the music business, brother. It's what it is.
Yeah.
I mean, literally, the day it says here on the liner notes, and I was really unaware of this until yesterday. The day that the album was, the record deal was to be signed, the FBI raided the FBI raided the record company, and everything was kind of put on hold, which obviously had to be supremely disappointing for you guys at the time to be told you know, like, so, but then what happened?
Terrible.
Did you come home after that, or was it more of a stick around and see what happens and hope, or what happened in that little time?
Well,
period?
You at that time we had recorded, like, it wasn't like LA. You went into the studio and you got your job done in a hurry because it was $180-$200 an hour in those days.
Yeah.
So when I went to England, it turned in, I thought it was going to be like 2-3 weeks, you do the album and you go home. But it turned into months and months and months.
Wow.
And you get into that lifestyle, you know, you're going to private clubs, you're drinking heavily. I mean, I was never a drinker to that degree, but boy, I sure learned how there, because everybody drank from morning till night, right? It was England. But finally it was done, and we sent it out to this Atlantic Records, and yeah, we went in on a Friday, got the call to come in on Monday, and over the weekend, the guy that signed us had been arrested by the FBI, and that was the end of that. And literally, I had to beg Bill Kerbishley, the manager of The Who, to get me a ticket home, because I didn't have a way to get home.
Oh, boy.
So you go from castles and private clubs and, you know, you're working with John Entwistle and blah, blah, blah. And yeah, I had to really beg to get a ticket back to Kamloops.
Jesus. So, like, now, did you come home and then go back out for the tour? Is that how that worked?
Yeah, I came home and then I went back again, which was another couple of months. Then I came home and he had the tour booked, and I went over there, rehearsed for a week, and we did, I think it was like 48 dates in 46 days. So it was one of those.
Jesus. That's nuts. That's nuts.
Well, what was really nuts was, you know, John was known for his volume and a singer, and you gotta monitor that's, you know, tiny, and you're trying to be heard, and yeah, man.
Oh, you got, yeah, no in-ear monitors back then. You were at the mercy of his
whatever
wall of sound blasting you from behind, and you're trying to hear yourself sing.
Yeah, it was a challenge, that's for sure.
Well, that had to have been a challenge, making you push your voice to hear yourself over him. But also 46 shows and 48 nights doesn't really help. You don't get much time off to heal there.
No. And during the day, literally, I couldn't make a sound. And then I would go into it. It was disappointing in a sense. I remember Neil Schoen from Journey came to one of the gigs in San Francisco. And the first set was not happening for me. And then it loosened up by the second set. But I remember him coming back and saying, oh, yeah, it was much better on the second set, which meant you really shit on the first one, right? Oh. So, you know, anyway.
But he doesn't know singers anyway. So. Chump band anyway. So I do have a clip from San Rafael, California show that was simulcast on Rockline across the USA, and from what I saw from watching the entire clip, this was either your second set or of the night, and this was the first one to be broadcast, or a second show that night as well too. Yeah. You might have, I know it sounded like they were really working you guys hard. That's for damn sure. It was
a really powerful band. It really was.
Yeah, the band sounded great. tight as hell. But I do recall a friend of mine from the Edmonton show when you guys played here. He was there for the sound check or something. He was talking to the sound man, and the sound man goes, he said to the sound man, he goes, "My God, that bass is loud." He goes, "He's not even in the fucking PA."
Yeah.
It's just like, it's just coming. Volume. It's just straight up stage volume.
It was incredible. And to this day, we were all hard of hearing. Yeah. Dean Townsend is hard of hearing, and so is Roger Daltrey. And at the time, John was, you seriously, from across the table, you had to really, "John, would you like another drink?" You know, you'd have to really raise your voice for him to hear you.
Well, I want to play this clip from that, it's videotape quality from 1988, and it's video mic quality from 1980 as well, too. But it gives you a sense of what was going on in the room here. I want to show everybody this clip from the John Entwistle Band in San Rafael, California, 1988, simulcast on Rockline. Check this out. Here we go.
Good evening, San Rafael. Would you please welcome, with new music just aired live on Rockline, all over the country, would you please welcome the John Entwistle Band?
Wow. What do you say other than that's just pretty damn cool, man.
Oh.
There we go. Got you muted there. You're on, sorry, bud. I haven't had to do the mic mute before, so I'm really helping you out.
I'm done peeing.
I wasn't sure I was going to ask you this or not, but I want to ask you. There was a couple of moments in that videotape on stage. Yeah, it seemed like there might have been a little tension on stage. Could I have been right? Just maybe a bad night, or was there a sense of you kind of just like, man, this is really not really working?
It worked. It was loud, pure and simple.
That's just
it. Just loud, and it was difficult to play. I mean, it was a great band. I mean, Tim Gorman had played, the keyboard player had been with the Who, the Rolling Stones. I mean, just a great Jefferson Starship. I mean, good personnel, but it was so loud, and we didn't play big places. You know, it would be 300 people, 400 people, 600 people, that kind of thing. And there wasn't tension really between the people. It was just like, it was work. It was work.
Because
of the volume. Yeah. And what? We had been traveling nonstop. So, and San Rafael, if I remember correctly, was towards the end of it all.
So, okay. All right. Yeah. I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to. I didn't think it was a personality thing. I thought more it was just you could just tell something was going on. I was like, the late in the tour, man, it's too freaking loud, and you know, because
I love John. I think, I wasn't a huge Who fan. I didn't. The songs that are great songs, you know, and the ones that I heard in the radio, I love. He was a gentleman, and he never raised his voice. He you know, when he died, I was devastated because we had just spoken a couple of weeks before, and he said he was going to send me some royalties, which that's not why I was devastated, but I remember laughing about that. But he was a great guy and a wonderful artist. He was just a talented guy, and a kind of a tragic figure in the sense that he was the true rock and roll guy. I mean, I remember him meeting, the story about Pete Townsend was kissing Bill Clinton's ass, and because Bill Clinton had come backstage and went over to John, and John had a bottle of Cavassier he was drinking down and stuck out his hand without even looking at him to say hi. And that was John. He was irreverent. He was not only a great bass player, but yeah, I really miss him.
And a difficult position for him as well, too, because he wasn't a very big money maker in the Who. He had to rely on those tours to make his money because he wasn't a songwriter.
There was a lot of tension there between him and Townsend. And I made the mistake one morning at breakfast to say, because he was mad at Townsend because he wanted to obviously tour, and Townsend didn't want to tour and blah, 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 and it cost John a lot of money. I mean, he died in debt. But I remember saying, you guys were rock and roll history. You grew up together, basically, and did all these great things. And shouldn't you be like a little more? And he, just didn't like Townsend. So it was very interesting to hear, to read in Townsend's book how close he and John were.
But, yeah.
So... anyway,
so there had to have been a point. Did the point come near the end of that tour? You're just kind of like, I'm gonna go back home to Kamloops and.
Well, I had two young kids.
Oh, you did by then. Okay, I didn't know that.
I had two young kids, and frankly, with that tour, there was a lot of drug use, and. There were nights where you're in a hotel room and you know what goes on after gigs and stuff. And where I kind of walked in the room and it's literally was like Spinal Tap. And that's kind of when I decided that whatever, I really wanted to go home. Yeah.
Yeah. I thought
to Kamloops.
I thought that Mike and Nick had come a little bit later, but... yeah, like Michael, Nicholas, and Samantha, your three awesome kids.
Yeah, yeah.
Really good kids. So you went to Kamloops, got back to Kamloops, became an awesome dad. And
they'd probably tell you something different.
No, they love you. I know that. Come on. Now, you kind of transitioned to a new gig, which was a morning radio personality on CIFM with the great and one and only Stan Bailey. And my glasses aren't working very good here. Here we go. There you are.
Well,
it's you and Stan on the morning show, man. And I tell you, when I moved to Kamloops, I was listening to you guys right away. It was a great show you guys had. And I think that's when I first met you. I got somehow I wrangled my way into having a little appearance on the morning show with you too, and came in, said hi. Chatted. I think I got you in trouble. We'll leave that out. But I got you in trouble that morning. I do remember that. But I'm discombobulated here. That's just it. The music and the songwriting part for you had never stopped. I mean, through the 90s and stuff, and late 90s, you were still writing, still recording. You had Small World Studios. You recorded an album called The Shift, mm-hmm. with a few local musicians in that, and then in after that you recorded your first solo CD in 2002 called Time, which mm-hmm. is right here. And I tell you, folks, this really is an exceptional, very very well received by music critics. Every review I saw on this album was just thumbs up, and everybody loved it. I highly recommend the song King of Fools. I recently sadly had to perform for a friend's funeral, and I decided that would be the song that I would do for them. And it was very, very difficult for me to sing and play, but it was, and it's been very well received by a few other friends I played it for. I've said, you know, a couple of guys, you should check this song out. You should really be playing it in your... So a couple of albums, working in Kamloops there at Small World Studios.
Yeah.
Kept the career going.
Obviously it wasn't what I had hoped for at that point. So, you know, I had kids and you had to make a living, and radio came along, which was great. And then, as you know, True River Junction came along, and that was a musical theater that was put on by the Rocky Mountain Railway, and that went on. And so, you know, Kamloops had always been kind of welcoming to me, and it all worked out.
See, the Two River Junction show.
Yeah, did you have to show that? Really? Like, I look worse than you.
I'm wearing a dress, for Christ's sake.
Now, and you're wearing a dress and a wig.
You know. You see, when I met you guys on the morning show that day, you offered me to audition for one of the roles. For the role of the Mountie, actually, in the Two River Junction show, and I ended up becoming kind of the Chris Farley, like one of the bank robbers instead. And I played a clip from that on my own Facebook page yesterday. And it was a delightful musical theater experience working for the Rocky Mountaineer Rail Tours. We did three shows a week, 500 people a show. 80 shows that year, and so we had 80,000 guests.
Yeah,
40,000 people saw that show. It's just was quite, and it was a real experience. Singing, dancing, multi instrument. You're playing, and you held it all together. You were the glue that put the show together, and I thank you for getting me that job, buddy. It was
you needed one at the time.
Yeah. Well, the cool thing about that job was that I could still go up and play Friday, Saturday at my gigs.
Yeah, Sunday. I told everybody that, you know, when there were, you know, there's always cast problems and this and that. And I said, you know what, this is the best musical gig you're ever going to have. And it was. You played for 40, the show was 45 minutes long. You drove home afterwards. That was it, you know, and had a full house every night.
That's it. Yeah, and Sunday, Tuesday, Thursday night worked out great in the schedule. Mm-hmm. It was a great experience. And you're like, I'm not going to pull any clips from the show or nothing like that. So
no, please don't.
Please don't. From there, that's when I started working with you at your recording studio there, Small World Studios. I worked with your son Nick and his band, The Vultures.
Yep.
Which I can.
They were a great band.
They were a great band. Really, really promising band. My God, they were good. But I can still smell Mark in the vocal booth.
Oh boy.
That smell, I know. Anyway, from there, now that's when I started working with you a little bit. Small World Studios. I almost forgot. I got to show everybody the commercial. You guys ready for this? Henry and I did a commercial for the studio, and it broadcast on the radio or the TV station. And this is gold, folks. Check it out. Here we go.
Your career is in the toilet. Small World Studios wants to help you with your next recording. You may be asking, what kind of music do we record? Blues. We do that. Rock. We do that. Jazz. We do that. Country. Yoo-hoo, we do that. And if you got some old records, we can turn them into CDs. At Small World Studios, we take our fun seriously, and we have serious fun. Give us a call. We might even call you back.
Yeah, we might even call you back. I just, you know, we did that in like 10 minutes there. That was like seriously.
Yeah, that was off the cuff. That was
nuts. Now it's getting dark behind you, so I'm gonna speed it up here a little bit here. I want to show a clip from us playing it. You graciously asked me to be your lead guitar player and the Henry Small Band. We just played a few gigs around the city and stuff. I just want to show a little snippet of us playing a gig at the Blue Grotto in Kamloops here a few years back. Now, there's that classic electric violin sound through a Fender distorted amp and a wah pedal that just created this Hendrix-like electric violin sound that has, to my ears, become a lot of basically your signature sound. I mean, it's you held a lot more of the lead duties down in that band than I did, that's for sure. And it was a pleasure to just kind of let you rip.
There was a reason for that. I could resist that. I paid for it again, you know.
Hey, that was a bird, wasn't it? So, now, well, that brings me to this. Oh, great, you got a light on there. Thank you. That brings me to this clip because I want to play this clip. Same venue, same song. Surprisingly a different key. I must have gotten you to do the half step down thing like I wanted there after a bit, but I wanted people to check this out. Same song, same venue, but different aspect. This is from the stage view with me with the camera on stage, and this is what happens when you pull a camera on Henry on stage. All right, here we go. That's my one of my favorite clips. You turn on me and just in perfect time, fuck you. I loved it. That's great. Now let's get caught up a little bit here. In 2012, you released another solo CD called Now and Then. And you still play gigs around the Kamloops region. In fact, you have a gig this Thursday night, August 27th. At the Kamloops Wildlife Park that is sold out, and they've made the venue look very much like a miniaturized Red Rock amphitheater type of situation. It looks really good from the pictures I saw. So that's this Thursday. But there's your latest release, a few years back. But again, another exceptional album of great songs, great musicians that you worked with. Your son Nick did that album cover.
Yeah, that was weird. I said, Nick, I need an album cover, and that's what he sent me the next day.
And he put the picture of him down in the corner there. I love that, too.
Yeah, now, he had to get in there.
Okay, now, we're caught up. Your gig is on the 27th, this Thursday. Now, I'm sorry for keeping you so long. Longest show I've ever done, and I still haven't got to the questions yet. So I'm just going to throw this up here, my friend. I'm going to nuke that out, and I'm going to hit you with this one. Let's get to it. Henry Small, what's the best gig you've ever played? The best gig you did?
I'd probably say opening for the Guess Who at the CNE. There was 45,000 people there, and they went nuts. And that was with Scrubbaloe Caine.
Wow. Like a nighttime set, afternoon set, or?
No, it was like a nighttime show. Right. And that gig is when Don Hunter, the manager of the Guess Who at the time, signed us and got us the RCA deal.
Wow.
So yeah, so that
a lot
probably,
of good came out of that night, eh?
Yeah, yeah. And it was fun, man. It was, you know, the band had just left Quebec after 7 months of seven nights a week and a matinee on Sunday, and We were pretty good at that time. We were pretty tight.
Good.
So, what would be the worst gig you've ever played?
Oh, God. I think we were in Oklahoma or something, and, you know, the old days, you went on a bus and you just did gigs every night, and I completely lost my voice, and we were opening for Kansas, or maybe it was Star, Banding Star or something. I don't remember, but there was 15,000 people there, and I didn't have a stand, nothing came out, nothing. Couple yeah. of squeaks, so I ran around the whole night, and they played instrumentals, and that was basically it. But I was pretty embarrassed, that's for sure.
That's yeah, that's it's not like you can just restring a vocal cord, you know, like you can a guitar. It's gone, right? Like,
and it was gone, and I was terrified. I mean, you know how you get before you play anyway. You're always anxious and kind of scared and whatever until you get started. And then it's, you know, you're fine. But, yeah, I remember that night for sure. Yeah.
So that leads me to, okay, what's the... And now, before I say that, I'm glad that you didn't mention when you said that. When I said what's the worst gig you've ever played, you didn't mention any gig you played with me. So that's good. So
no, you know what? And not saying this, I always thought that you were a great guy to have around, and in so many ways. I mean, technically, and your guitar playing, I thought was very soulful because you've been through so much in your life, and it comes out in your guitar playing. So. I would never say that about you until we're off the show, and then I'll talk about you. But
thanks, buddy. I love you, man.
No.
Okay. Give us your craziest road story. What's the wildest, God. Wildest thing that happened that, you know, we change the name, of whatever.
Man,
you need.
That's a hard one. There's some really crazy stuff, but I don't want to get into it. You know, couple of biker stories in Quebec were pretty wild, but you know, overall the road's the road. It hasn't changed much. It's changed forever now, but in those days, you know, it was anything went, man. And being a musician on the road was hard, but you were young, and you know, it was nuts. It was just nuts from beginning to end.
Just a crazy time.
Yeah, I mean, you'd see guys. I remember one guy who I won't name, but he had discovered Jesus. And after about 5 weeks on the road, it sure wasn't freaking Jesus, but, you know.
Well, man, you know, I think I've pretty much run out of my notes. The longest bio, the best gig, the worst gig, the craziest road story. I thank you for the kind words. This is a shot of you and me from our very first gig together in a band when we played out at Quayot Lodge out in the Shishwa.
I remember that gig.
New Year's Eve. We didn't have a light show or anything like that, and we just kind of set up in a giant circle room. That had the worst acoustics ever, but and poor Matt, our drummer Matt Stanley, his first real live drumming gig, and God, you remember the night we played the Grotto with him, and we went to start the third set, and we got into about the second song, and he goes, "Guys, I gotta pee," and it's like, well, it's too late now. We got another 45 minutes to go yet. No, I really gotta pee, and then I remember you, hey everybody. Matt's got a pee, so let's let Matt go and pee. So I think we let Matt go off the stage, and he went to the bathroom, and we were just all laughing because the bar is packed, and we're waiting for Matt to pee, and we're calling him, come on, hurry up Matt. And he comes back to the stage, and he go, did you pee? And he go, no, I couldn't pee because I knew everybody was watching. But
yeah,
playing with you, we had great times, and it was a fun band, and it was fun. You know what I miss from that band was the eye contact around. You know, I mean, I keep me and Leon and Matt, we were just like watching you all the time. And it was like we kind of, after a while, got to know where you wanted to go with songs and what you wanted to do up and down and that. And it was a treat playing with a professional, that's for sure. And it really, I learned a lot working with you, believe it or not.
Thank you. And, well, that's a good thing.
Well, I did. And working in the studio, I had no idea what I was doing. I still don't know what I'm doing, but...
You became a pretty good engineer, that's for sure, for a guy that started from nowhere. And, yeah, you got into it, and you know damn well you were pretty good at it.
We were the anti-Pro Tools studio, that's for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
You want Pro Tools? Yeah, you're in the wrong spot.
Yeah, go somewhere else.
Yeah. Now... this is a new record, 1 hour and 41 minutes. I'm going to hit your name here one more time, and I'm just going to say it's been a real pleasure to have you as my guest tonight.
Thanks, man.
It's been a real treat to have worked with you over the years. It's been an honor to have you as my friend, and I love you dearly. I really do. I miss the hell out of you, buddy, and I hope to see you real soon. I'm coming to see my mom in a few weeks, and we'll
make
be driving,
sure.
driving through town, and I definitely want to
make
get
sure
together.
I'd like to meet the saint that you live with.
Well, sadly, she'll probably be staying home working because somebody's got to do that in this environment these days. Us musicians
yeah,
aren't really
no
working.
Kidding.
That's why we're doing this, Henry.
I know.
So,
all
again,
right.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to your girlfriend for helping out tonight, and very much to just thanks again. I love you. Say hi to the kids for me, and
I will.
Take care, Henry, man. I really do love you, and I'll see you again real soon. Just hit that leave room button, and we're all done. And I'll get this online, and I'll send you a link in a little bit. All right, my friend.
Take care. Thanks, Mikey.
Love you, man.
Thank you. Love you too.
I love that guy. It was an honor to work with him, an honor to know him. I'm proud of him, I'm proud of his career, and I hope we cleared some of the mud up. And I hope I did him proud tonight. Exceptional singer, one of the best singers I've ever heard in my life. A genuinely nice guy, and very supportive, and I love him. It was a treat working with him. It was a treat to get to know him, and it was a treat to become his friend, more important than anything. So thanks again, Henry Small. This is my longest show yet, 1 hour and 45 minutes I'm coming up to here. I'd like to remind everybody one more time here, thanks to my sponsor, Fortification Security Solutions, my good buddy Fort McMurray, who I love as well. Check him out, and please, if you need any locksmith work done, if you locked out of your car, he's the first guy to call. Fortification. Look it up, and there it is. He's the man. He's the man. Once again, go to Party Hog on my Facebook page. Go to at the Party Hog on my YouTube page, and at Party Hog on my Instagram page. Also, tell you what, screw all that shit and just go to partyhog.com, okay? Just go to the partyhog.com website, and you can catch previous Road Story shows that have been on there as well. I just want to bring that picture up one more time. Yeah, New Year's Eve on our way to... walking down the hallway from the hotel room to my first gig playing with the guy I saw at my very first rock and roll concert, and ended up working in a recording studio with him. It's just this was a real treat for me tonight, folks. big time treat. And I thank you all for tuning in. I thank you all for sticking around this long. Much love to everybody. Please can check out partyhog.com. Also, one other thing, please Google up Henry Small, find him on YouTube. I highly recommend the two Small Wonder albums. They are on my Mike Braniff YouTube page. So you can check them out there. So please check them out at that site. Small Wonder, the Scrubbaloe Caine stuff is on YouTube as well. And trust me, Henry Small, King of Fools. YouTube that shit right now. You will not regret it. Thanks again, you guys. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for all the comments. And with peace and love, I'm going to finally sign off here tonight. And yet again, thanks for tuning in. This Wednesday night will be the last basement show of season one. And we've got some special treats planned up. My guest next Monday is none other than Keith Retson Spalding. You may know him as the fantastic keyboard player and singer from the band Click. I also worked with him in the Joint Chiefs as well. And he's currently been working around the world as one of the best musicians working at the cruise ships. And but I don't know. I think the 80s stories might rival what happens on the cruise ship stories. So anyway, thanks again for tuning in, and we'll see you next week. Same hog time, same hog channel right here on partyhog.com, Hog TV. Thanks again, boys and girls. Cheers to you. And good night. Bye-bye. How's this work?